Good evening, excellencies, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Kishore Mabubani. I'm the Dean of the LKY School of Public Policy, and it gives me great pleasure to welcome you to this event. Anyway, as you all know, it's a tradition I keep religiously to only make 3 points in my introduction. My first point will be about the school, second point about the topic, and the third point about the speaker. And I'll try to be as brief as possible so we can give more time to the speaker today. The first point about the school, the reason I want to speak about the school is that, as you all know, the school has been remarkably successful over the course of its now approaching nine years of its existence. We mentioned we've gone from being a new school to becoming the third best endowed school of public policy in the entire world, the second most generous school of public policy in the entire world, the second largest executive education programs, and of course we have a brilliant faculty and absolutely wonderful academic programs. But the reason why we've had this remarkable transformation is because we've had only one chairman of the governing board since the beginning. His name is Professor Wang Gungwu. So a special round of applause for Professor Wang. He's provided remarkably dedicated service to the school, giving us good advice, and Margaret and Gungwu always turn up for valedictory dinners and support our students. It's remarkable what you've done for us, Gungwu, and we thank you very much. The second one is the topic, of course, and frankly, the topic about renewal and the Chinese state is the most important topic in the world today, bar none. I can confidently say that the outcome of the 21st century will depend on how China emerges once again as a great power. And clearly, no one has the answers. There are many narratives out there. If you listen to the Western narrative in the calls on China to become a responsible stakeholder and all, you get the sense that the West actually expects that in one way or another, as China emerges, it will become westernized. And you see this remarkable expectation somehow in the West that this country, China, with 4,000 years of history, this huge barrel of Chinese history, they want to try and funnel it into this narrow 200-year funnel of Western domination of world history. And that's going to be a challenge. And clearly, I suspect that's not how things will evolve. Which is why in this book that we're going to launch today, which Gungwu shared with me, I came across a wonderful passage which I want to read to you from the book because it explains to you very well the importance of the topic we are addressing today. And this is what Gungwu says, and I quote, "Modern China has been torn between affirming the integrity of its history despite the Sino-centric bias and accepting world history in the Eurocentric tradition. This ambivalence has not helped other people understand China's position in world history." Why this ambivalence? China obviously does not wish to accept a narrative that reads history backwards to take European history since the 17th and 18th centuries as the norm, together with other peoples with a strong heritage of their past. The Chinese think it is unhistorical to impose one dominant narrative upon everyone's past, unquote. With this simple passage, Gungwu explains what a difficult mission it is to believe that China will forget its 4,000 years of history and become like every other country. And that's why I think this book is so important. Of course, now this brings me to the most important point, to say a word about the speaker. And the challenge I have about introducing the speaker in 2 minutes is that there's so much to say. Fortunately for me, there was a book that was recently launched by the East Asian Institute and edited by Cheng Yongyan and Pua Kok Koo, KK Pua, and it's a book called Wang Gungwu, Educator Scholar. So I can assure you that there's so much rich information here. Even though we're not here to launch this book, I recommend this book to all of you here. Because if you read this book, as it says in the introduction, you'll find that Gungwu has always been described as a Chinese word, which I'll mispronounce, of course. I mean, Chunse, the scholar gentleman in Mandarin. But I would describe him not as a gentleman scholar, but as a giant scholar. He has been remarkably productive, producing over 50 books. And this is, I guess, a message to all members of faculties everywhere. And if you want a description of the 50 books, it's here. But what's remarkable has been that he's been able to be so productive while at the same time holding many senior administrative positions, including being Vice Chancellor of the University of Hong Kong and Director of East Asian Institute. It seems that nothing can stop Gungwu from producing great books. He's also had, by the way, a fascinating life. Now, I won't describe all his 80 over years of his life, but let me just describe his early life to get a flavor of how rich his beginnings were. He was born in Surabaya, Indonesia in 1930. Then came, as you know, the Great Depression, and the Great Depression forced Professor Wang's family to leave Surabaya and moved to Ipoh, Perak, by the end of 1931. Just as he completed Standard 5, the equivalent of Primary 5, in 1941, World War II came along and disrupted his studies. And then after the war, his family moved to Nanjing, China. He was accepted at the National Central University of Nanjing in 1947, where he studied foreign languages, but then came along the Civil War in China, and that forced the closure of the university, and he returned to Ipoh at the end of 1948. And then Malaya was then put under a state of emergency declared by the British government against the Malayan Communist Party, and as a result of which, partly of that, Professor Wang came to Singapore and studied here at the Bukit Timah campus in 1949. And he graduated from here, went on to get a PhD in London, and as I say, the rest is history. So, Gungwu, over to you.
I'd much rather talk about the Japanese occupation and the emergency than about this book. In many ways, it's so much easier to tell a story that has a beginning, a middle, and an end. The book itself, of course, is not really quite a book. I'm not satisfied with it because I didn't really set out to write this book. I have to confess that I'm now writing the book. This was actually a set of lectures I gave. It climaxed in some lectures I gave at the Chinese University of Hong Kong in honor of a very dear friend of mine, one of the greatest scholars, living scholars today of Chinese history, Professor Yu Yingshi. We're actually the same age, but we've known each other since we were students together. Students age. His father was a professor of history at the Nanyang University when it first started. And Professor Yu went to Hong Kong and studied under Professor Qian Mu, another great Chinese scholar. I didn't have the privilege of doing that. And contrasting my life with his has been one of the inspirations for me, because it was his experience as someone who was born and brought up in China, very much deep in the Chinese tradition, both on his father's side and on his education under Professor Qian Mu, who's one of the great traditional historians of China. He carried forward the representative traditional historiography of Qianmu into his own work. He had done almost the whole range of Chinese history. If you look at his work, he recovered ancient history, the whole of intellectual history, and very much the political history of the place of the scholar and intellectual in the way the Chinese state had developed over the centuries. That was his specialty. Now, why I use him as a kind of a foil, you might say, for myself, is that I have the opposite experience of having been born and brought up outside of China, and having had to try and understand China from the outside, unlike Professor Yu Yingshi, who really understood China from the inside. But what was really remarkable, of course, when we look at his career and my career, was that he too was forced to look at China from the outside, because he couldn't go back to communist China. He went on after Hong Kong, he went to America, he did his PhD at Harvard. He ended up his career as a professor at Princeton, and his brilliant career. And he was forced to look at China from the outside by the conditions in China. And he took a very forceful and very distinctive position about the China after 1949, which made him quite a political figure in the field. And it's because he felt so deeply about what happened in China that he took that position. So that as a historian, while he was being an excellent scholar in history, he also took a political position about China throughout his career. He's done something which I understand, but I do not share, and I did not fully appreciate why he did so, and that he has never been back to China, never went back to the People's Republic of China. And that is a political statement from him. So the contrast is just, to me, very striking. Here am I, an outsider, trying to understand China, and having been to China numerous times and still having considerable difficulty understanding that vast country with its very long history, still struggling to understand. He has a particular understanding of a China that is no longer there. And he writes with deep regrets, with deep feeling, and you can see the pain, and sometimes I would say a deep, very deep pain at what he sees as a loss of a China that might have been or should have been in his eyes. So there is a China that has developed since 1949, and as our dean has alerted us, may well become even more and more significant as the century goes on and China develops further and finds its place in the world again as a dominant force, perhaps, to be reckoned with by everyone. So that is one China that's going on, developing. And then there's the China that Yu Yingshi regrets that no longer can be, and he feels the loss very deeply. And then there's me, struggling outside still, trying to understand this powerful resurgence of both economic and ultimately political influence in the world, but from the outside. And then I find myself, as someone who's been studying history, continually facing the question of, where does Chinese history come into this? I mean, Yu Yingshi's understanding of the Chinese history is that somehow it was lost. There's a kind of discontinuity in the present China. I don't share that. Despite my great admiration for Yu Yingshi's scholarship on Chinese history, I think he has been affected by his deep passion for that history, not to see what is happening in China today, or not wanting to see, or not admitting what is happening in China today. And I understand that, but I don't share that. I have a different perspective on this. Seeing it from China from the outside, and I seeing China from the outside and looking at Chinese history, the whole length of Chinese history, as much as I can, from the outside, by people from the outside, from the edges of China, as well as those far away, how they see it, I come to a different conclusion about China's future, and I understand China in quite a different way from my dear friend Yun Shi. Now, these lectures I gave don't reflect all that, because it was a lecture given in honor of Yun Shi. So I try to tell my story, my side of the story, in a preliminary sort of way. But having to tell it in that way has inspired me to want to write a book about that, which I'm now beginning to do. But these thoughts that I put into the essays represent some of my thinking about this. And let me just say a few more words about what my struggle with Chinese history has been. I guess the word really, the problem really begins with the very word itself, history. History is actually a European word. It comes from the Greek, it comes from the Greco-Roman tradition, and it comes from centuries of evolution in the European, first Judeo-Christian context, as well as the post-Renaissance context and Enlightenment context, and then the modern tradition of history writing, which really only began in the 18th century, the professionalization of the historian, a profession that is derived from the sense of scientific objectivity that could only have come about because of the scientific revolution in Europe itself. So it's a marriage of a long storytelling tradition in the Judeo-Christian and Greco-Roman tradition, plus the scientific revolution, leading scholars to believe that scholars and intellectuals have a role beyond that of church and state, a role that allows them to be a force in change, in progress, in human development, by being objective, scientific, and being professional about the study of the past. And the profession of historian really came from that. Now, that is something quite totally different. There is no such thing as the history profession in China. So the word history in China has a completely different set of meanings, at least to my understanding. And that is what has made it so fascinating to me. The word history is shi, as the Chinese pronounce it. Today we call it li shi to make it two sounds, but the original word is shi. And shi stems originally from the idea of respect for records, respect for documents, respect for everything that has been recorded. It has something to do with literacy and civilization, and of course the role of the state, all packed into one, because only a civilized, literate state will produce the kind of records that then allow for continuity, and based on that continuity, will build that state into something greater and greater over time. So this is the whole implication of the word shi. So it has nothing to do with the profession of history, it has nothing to do with scientific explanation, it has to do with the role of people conscious of their past and wanting to make that past into something that builds into a future. So the correlation between past, present, and future was given, inseparable, and that who determines that would be those who are responsible for governing, ruling, looking after the people and the state of that particular country. And that is sort of packed into this one word. I mean, I'm overstating it a little bit, perhaps, because I'm reading a lot into it. But if you look at the history of the word and how it developed over time in China, you can see the connection. And so the relationship between history and the state has been very strong right from the beginning. And what struck me in the end, after years and years of struggling with this, is to look at the present today and where history has come in. I grew up, of course, at a time when the dominant historical narrative was the Western one, which the Dean has referred to, which has 200 or 300 years of history, professionalization of the historian, teaching in universities, writing history books, and so on, in a modern way, almost a progressive way, building into the whole tradition the idea of progress and a narrative based on a kind of goal to which our human society would move. And yet in China, what had happened was the tradition of shi was challenged by the end of the 19th century, and forcing the Chinese intellectuals, the leaders, the mandarins, the government, the rulers of China to rethink what this history means. Something that came from outside but has had imposed a certain pattern of thinking on the Chinese of the new generation after 1900 in the 20th century. And initially, what was very interesting, the Chinese accepted that. They rewrote their history. It's quite extraordinary how they rewrote it. They rewrote their history in terms which we would describe today as a kind of national history. For this, they have to thank the Japanese. They were greatly influenced by the Japanese because the West was introduced to China very largely to the Japanese, who during the Meiji Revolution restoration had translated vast numbers of Western works into Japanese, and the Chinese found it easier to in fact learn, read the Japanese translations and translate them back into Chinese rather than go directly to the whole range of Western languages from which the Japanese had translated. And out of that, they took at the same time the Japanese narrative of the Japanese nation and all the implications of the Japanese emperor and the nationhood that the Japanese claimed. So it was kind of imperial nation which the Japanese had written for themselves. The Chinese were influenced by that. And they found that the way the Japanese modernized themselves with the usage of Western historiographical perspectives helped them to develop their response to the West. And so the early generations of historians were really using the Japanese version of Western narrative to rewrite their history, and they did. They went through a stage of rewriting Chinese history as if China was from the very beginning, a nation for which it was a continuous history from the origins to the present day. That was not satisfactory to many people. People realized there was something not quite right, but not quite sure what to do with it, because they were tremendously influenced by the need to modernize their perspective on the world. And so they continued to do that. And they were challenged, interestingly enough, by another group of historians who felt that the national narrative was not correct. There was something more important than that, more universal, international, and in a way, more consistent with the scientific dialogue that was going on, that was part of the modern revolution that both Japan and China accepted from the West. The total knowledge of science and technology that was essential for modern development. So they took that as well. And in that context, nationalism was seen as very narrow. Nationalism was the cause of World War I, which virtually destroyed much of the Western tradition, and ultimately to World War II, which basically restructured the power relationships in the world, which had been so dominated by Western Europe for 200 years. So the Chinese who interpreted that looked elsewhere, and they looked to the Soviet Union, to Marx and Lenin, and into China through the Chinese Communist Party, and rewrote their history in the context of that Leninist or Marxist-Leninist interpretation of history, which, of course, is itself Western, but it was an alternate version of the Western nationalist narrative. It was supposed to be anti-nationalist, internationalist, and that was the contrast. And, of course, this became part and parcel of the political battle in China that was ultimately won by the internationalists led by the Chinese Communist Party, and they threw out the nationalists and spoke in terms of an internationalist China, rewriting their history in terms of the kind of categories that Marx had determined, rewriting all of it, and in fact, quite frankly, writing a history that was pretty nearly unrecognizable to those who were brought up in the traditions of Chinese Shi in the past. So you can see the struggle that has been going on even in China. So I like to think that it's not only my struggle, it's a struggle of all the Chinese people with their past and that struggle is still going on. I mean, that's how I would like to see that, partly to make it a little easier for myself, because I'm struggling. But to cut a long story short, because that's part of something that I am going to write, I am actually writing on already. But to cut a long story short, let me just bring it down to the present. The present situation to me has made history, in the Chinese traditional sense of shi, probably more important to the Chinese than even they realize. Why do I say that? Because throughout Chinese history, Chinese knowledge was basically all of knowledge was grouped under four headings. One was Jing, which means the classics. And the way it developed, the classics meant all the classics that were approved of by Confucian scholars. They were Jing, the classics. And that's about one quarter of China's knowledge was gathered under the classics. About one quarter was gathered under the classification called Shi, which I translate as history, but not quite the same meaning, but Shi. And it included all the records to do with governance, leadership, development, political, economic, social development over time, a long history of 4,000 years. All this material, anything related to that, including administrative local and provincial structures, everything is described under Shi. The third category, I'll be brief, the third category consists of almost everything else in knowledge, particularly in the sciences, technology, anything to do with handbooks about agriculture, about construction, architecture, all the practical things in life, including the philosophical schools that were rejected by Confucius, or not accepted by Confucius as part of the classics, the leftovers, as it were, of philosophical thought that were developed in ancient times, including, of course, even new ideas brought in by the Buddhists, so that Taoism, Buddhism, all the other isms, as it were gathered together with science, technology, and practical knowledge in the third division. And the final section is literature. By literature, very broadly, collections of everything written by scholars in the fields of poetry, prose, anything else. All the official documents have been collected under the last one called Ji. So Jing Shi Zi Ji is the whole knowledge, all knowledge of China were classified in these four groups, of which Jing was number one and very dominant. No one who claims to be a scholar can do without knowledge of the Jing, otherwise they're just not accepted, not taken seriously. This is the context. What has happened since 1949 in particular, but since 1900 with the coming of the West and the rewriting of history, the most important thing that happened over the last 100 years or so is the loss of Jing altogether. To replace Confucianism, they had to find something else. They tried. The Kuomintang never could find anything, but the communists did. They tried to replace the Confucian Jing with the Marxist-Leninist, Maoist Jing, and they're still struggling to do that, but it hasn't really succeeded. And what has happened in the last 30 years in particular have really questioned that Jing. The new Jing simply doesn't work, and it hasn't replaced the old Jing. So in effect, that one quarter of the knowledge that was superior to all other knowledge, which was Confucianism and to be Marxism, Leninism, Maoism, that one hasn't worked. And the people of China, to my knowledge, the vast number of the people of China don't really buy that anymore. And is not going to have the same power over the development of China that Confucianism had for nearly 2,000 years. So that, I think, is the big development, which is very difficult for the Chinese people or the Chinese leadership to publicly acknowledge. But I think the reality is the Jing has not been replaced by a new Jing. So what has, I think, in effect happened is that the Shi, that category called history, is replacing the Jing. And is replacing the Jing in many fascinating ways. And I won't go into all of it, but just to illustrate it, it is there because it explains the nature of the state. It explains how a state came about, and it explains how the state is governed, rules, all the rules and regulations, administrative and others, laws that enable the state to perform its role. All there are categorized under the Shi. It is a continuity of all the experiences, and this includes ancient through the Middle Ages, as it were, down to modern times, to the current times. Everything that could be relevant to how China be governed is categorized in this body of knowledge. Today, in modern terms, we would say, lots of it now, in the West, we call it social sciences. Somewhere it's a social sciences, but social sciences are included under this category of Shi, because the Chinese didn't have the idea of social sciences, but recognize that the Shi that they now have inherited is no longer the Shi that was primarily couched in Chinese traditional Confucian humanistic terms, but now has to take into account all the developments of modern economic, scientific, and technological achievements, which is part and parcel of that. So it is a kind of more scientific Shi that the modern Chinese would see this body of knowledge. The key point I have in my own mind is that this Shi is very much linked with the Chinese state, as it has always been. It has always been linked up with the Chinese state. So that the nature of the Chinese state cannot be totally separated from the way they perceive their continuity between this present state and all the states before it. And this is how the whole of Chinese history, the sense of Chineseness, the sense of Chinese distinctiveness, and if I may use the word very reluctantly, a kind of Chinese exceptionalism that they borrowed from the Americans, the Chinese exceptionalism stems from this fact that it has a unique link with that long and distant past, which has been continuous down to the present. In a sense, they are denying that there was any discontinuity between the 20th century China and the China of the 20 centuries earlier before that. And that is itself a remarkable contribution to how the new generations of Chinese are being led to think, whether they like it or not. Because it is not a comfortable one, and I'm not at all suggesting to you that this is settled. I'm saying that this is an ongoing process. And how the Chinese people, leaders, the Communist Party, and others involved in the thinking about China today, how they resolve this issue of their relationship with the past will tell us a lot about Chinese history and Chinese future. Let me end with just two or three examples of how powerful this is. And that is how the Chinese have used the past and how Chinese are using the past. Just very simple examples. Now, let me contrast to begin with how the West uses the past. It's actually very well known how the past is used. The first example I gave is how the West rewrote their history in the last 200 years to make it national history. And we're very much influenced by that today. That is the dominant historical narrative, to turn every history into national history. It started with the history of the French, and later on and Britain. But maybe one can go further back to the history of the Dutch, when they got their independence from the Spanish Netherlands and started to write the history of the Netherlands. That was the beginning of this national history. But they were not so powerful. It was France and Britain. They were the most powerful in the 19th century. And when they started to write national history, that became the model. The model that I mentioned earlier on about the Japanese used that as a model to rewrite the whole Japanese history in those terms. The difference was between Japan and China was Japan was much more homogeneous and really did have one simple history, untouched, uninvaded by others. They were left alone for the last 2,000 years. And nobody actually succeeded in invading Japan or even tried to, so except the Mongols for a short while. And they therefore found it relatively easy to develop a national history narrative based on their traditional history. But this does not apply to China. In fact, it cannot apply to China. China is not that kind, did not have that kind of history. So that's a separate problem. But to illustrate the extent to which this problem creates for anybody who studies the past, and this is my own moment of enlightenment. I was still a student then when from this university, actually, in the library, which is now the Blue Bali restaurant. It was my library. You can see it's a very small library. But in a moment of just curiosity, I picked up a book called The History of Belgium. Brand new book. So very interesting, History of Belgium. I knew it was bilingual, all kinds of struggles, so I thought I'd find out more about it. But what struck me at the time was that it was a history that began, the whole history of Belgium, as it were, went back, right back to ancient archaeology, to the Roman period, and then to all the feudal kingdoms in between, and then in a kind of silo, using the present boundaries of Belgium, history of Belgium came up like that, and there was a history. And Belgium at the end, after the 19th century, that was the history of Belgium. And I thought there's something wrong with that, because there's a lot of Roman history, a lot of Germanic tribes fighting all around the place, and a lot of things that happened during the feudal period with all the princes fighting and all the different dynastic houses quarreling about religion, about state, and so on. But all that was reduced because anything that happened outside the boundary was left out. Everything that was happened inside was kept in. So that was the history of Belgium. So I began to wonder about this national history ever since then. I've never been persuaded thereafter that there is such a thing as national history, to be honest. All national histories are artificially constructed to fit the particular borders that happened to be there at that time. And you write a history accordingly. When the borders change, for example, I don't know how people are going to write the history of Yugoslavia, for example. You know, how will you do that? You know, the national history of Yugoslavia becomes different little national histories. I mean, just an example of my moment of enlightenment, my rejection of national history, and my skepticism ever since towards any effort to write national history. So that's my problem. You can see where my problem began. So ever since then, I've been wondering, if you don't have national history in this dominant historical narrative that we have inherited from a very powerful and successful West for the last 200 years, how do we write history? So the West itself has learned after the two world wars. A new generation of historians have tried to write world history, trying to write something which is borderless, take out the national borders, look at human history, global history. They're looking for all sorts of ways of doing that. And I'm greatly in sympathy with that. I've tried to understand what they've been doing. It is remarkable what has been achieved. But all that has been contested. All along the way, there's no agreement how to do this. But there is at least, at the base of it, even the global history, the world history that's been written today, is very hard to get away from the national perspectives that keep on intruding themselves into the narrative, whether you like it or not. So maybe we have no way of escaping from national history. That is the dominant form, and we may have to live with it indefinitely. But let me say that I'm not yet prepared to surrender, as it were, to that. I would like to think about what are the kinds of alternatives. And the example of Belgium is one. Another one is, for example, the rise of Germany, rise of Japan. And because it rose and became powerful and rich, they started two world wars. I mean, this is how the narrative goes. So they blame it all on Germany and Japan. But actually, is it as simple as that? I'm not so sure. It is a kind of national rivalries that were created out of nationalism that was, again, artificially and emotionally raised to such high levels that it became impossible for the leaders to avoid fighting each other and killing millions, as it were, in the course of doing that. So all that is related to how history has been used in that national framework. In Chinese terms, you can see the difficulties when they try to use this national history to rewrite their Chinese history. Let me give you just two examples. One very primitive one, very simple one. One from the Taiwan and one from mainland. They're just two examples of how difficult it can be. The Taiwan one was a very interesting one. They used the whole of Chinese traditional history to talk of dynastic histories. And they said, this communist regime in mainland is just another new dynasty. And in dynastic terms, the kind of cruelty that Mao Zedong practiced, the kind of destruction of the intellectuals through the Great Leap Forward down the Cultural Revolution and all that suggests, and Mao Zedong himself boasts of being that, he's nothing but Qin Shi Huang. So immediately the analogy of Mao Zedong with Qin Shi Huang leads them to the conclusion that, like the Qin dynasty, it wouldn't last long. Now, this is a Chinese analogy. The Qin dynasty didn't last long. It was succeeded by the Han dynasty, which presumably would be the nationalists, of course. But then Qin Shi Huang didn't last long. So they used Chinese history analogy for a short while. They no longer do it. But if you read the 1950s, 60s narratives among the Kuomintang historians, there were many who used this Qin Shi Huang analogy to say that the PRC can only have a short history. It's only a short dynasty, after which there'll be the great dynasties to follow. And they used the Qin, they also used the Sui Wendi, Sui Yangdi as a precursor of the great Tang dynasty. Again, very short dynasties. So that's one conclusion they did. The PRC example, completely different one, but it raises really difficult questions about Chinese historiography. There are many examples, but I take this one because it is still current today. It started in the 1950s when a historian raised the question of whether UFA was a national hero. Now, UFA is a man who was a general in the Southern Song Dynasty who fought against the Georgian invaders of the Southern Song who had conquered most of North China. And UFA comes from one of the border provinces of Henan, and he was leading a group of people who tried to fight back and recover North China for the Southern Song Dynasty. And he did it, of course, in the context of the Song Emperor, the dynastic house of Song. He probably also did it for his own sake, because he and his family around Henan and the frontier was always in great danger of being invaded by the Georgians. But whatever his motives, he tried to fight. He was prevented from fighting. Eventually, he was executed by the Song Emperor for reasons too complex to enter into here. But the net result was he became a hero to the Chinese people. The man who wanted to fight the Georgians, who was prevented from fighting, and in the end executed instead, despite his willingness to fight on behalf of the Song Emperor. So the heroic picture of UFA thereafter became very strong among the ordinary people, not among the ruling class. The ruling elites of Song, of course, the Mongols would know, the Ming and the Qing and all the Mandarin classes and so on, never really gave him that much emphasis. But for the ordinary people, he was a hero. And this image of UFA was brought to the fore during the war against Japan, the Sino-Japanese War. The Kuomintang raised the image of UFA to be the national hero, representing the spirit of a China that was defending China and saving China from Japanese conquest. And it was tremendously important. I mean, as a child, I grew up with the image of UFA as the great hero. His poem, Man Jiang Hong, was turned into a very famous song. I sang that with great pride when I was a young man, because it represented a spirit of defiance, courage, willingness to defend your interest against the enemy. And it was a heroic image. Now, in 1950s, when the Chinese Communist Party won, the Chinese historians raised the question. The Georgians were the ancestors of the Manchus. The Manchus were now part of China. They're one of the 55 nationalities of China. So fighting against the Georgians is kind of civil war. It's not a national hero. There was no sense of nation. The Song Dynasty was not a nation, and the Georgians were not another nation, two nations fighting each other. This is imposing the national narrative onto traditional history. That should not be so. So they suggested that maybe UFA should not be described as a national hero, but as a heroic man in his own image. You don't have to call him a national hero. There was a tremendous uproar. People were outraged at the suggestion that UFA should not be a hero. And the subject sort of died down and became a kind of academic subject, and nobody pursued it very much longer. But you can see deep feelings arose when this question. In other words, what had happened in the last 100 years was that there's a new sense of nation, national, and the UFA was a symbol of this growth of a nationalism that the young generation of China, several young generations of China, had internalized in themselves, and it's become very powerful. But what's very interesting is that many of you would have noted that in the last few days, the image of your faith came up again in the context of the Po Xi Lai trial. I don't know whether you've noticed it or not, but that has now happened. Why? Because the supporters of Po Xi Lai are really saying, this is like your faith. The man who wanted to do good, to bring a new spirit into China, reform China so they'd be less corrupt and more advantages and so on, is now being tried in a show trial, which will end up in jail, all pre-scripted, as it were. So the accusation is that the government of China today is behaving like the Song Huizong and his ministers of the Southern Song Dynasty, and going to destroy this national hero that is Po Xi Lai. Now, I'm not saying one way or the other. As you can imagine, I have no way of judging this, but I'm just illustrating to you how powerful these images of the Chinese past is, not only in the language, but is in the minds, and how it is also evolving, how you can change it. Chinese history is not stagnant, it's not just one story. It is a narrative that is continually evolving, and people evolve and use the history to develop new ideas, new perspectives of the past, as well as new perspectives of the future, current, past, present, and future. And this is going on all the time. Now you can see what a terrible job I have to try and understand all this. So I hope, before I end, to simply invite you to be sympathetic with me when I continue with my struggles with Chinese. Thank you.
Thank you, Gungwu. That was brilliant. I'm gonna ask the first difficult question. And then I'm sure there'll be many others coming. My first difficult question actually is a simple one. You know, you mentioned about the Chinese Communist Party struggling between its sort of internationalist, Marxist-Leninist ideology and its awareness of the history in the past. If Mao Zedong and Zhou Enlai were sitting in the front row, listening to you, because they, on the one hand, both Mao and Zhou, I think, emphasized their credentials as representative of the Communist Party, but both also had a very deep sense of Chinese history, and they realized that Chinese history also legitimized their rule in Beijing. So how would they feel in response to your question about the dilemmas that you express here? Which side would they lean on?
It's a very tough one. Both Mao Zedong and Zhou Enlai are very brilliant men with very complex personalities, very complex minds. I don't think I can match their minds to know how they would think. But let me put it this way. Mao Zedong had a very, very keen sense of Chinese history. There's no doubt whatsoever. He read history more than anything else in the world. I actually suspect that he read history far more than he read Marx or Lenin. And that he understood Chinese history much better than he understood Marx or Lenin. And he was really rewriting Chinese history in his own mind, borrowing some of the new ideas from the West, from both the nationalist as well as the internationalist perspectives, and re-understanding Chinese history and his own future role in China's own future development. I think in his mind, he wanted to do something great for China in the best tradition of the great rulers of China. In that sense, he's almost, you might say, nationalistic, except it isn't that. It is his feeling of continuity with the great leaders of China.
Because he felt that he was continuous from the past.
He identified with that past very fully. But at the same time, he recognized the future out there, which was provided, as it were, the instruments were provided with the communist ideology, communist international, the internationalist image, which gave him a chance to project China as a leader of the world. That if he succeeded in being the great leader of China, and China succeeded in playing its role in history, China would be the leader of that international world in which the internationalist interpretation of China would be of the world would be interpreted by Mao Zedong's China. To that extent, he had grandiose expectations of combining the great traditions of China with the internationalist message for the whole world. And the fact that he didn't succeed. The fact that he didn't succeed was probably because he thought well beyond what was physically possible for both China and for the people outside to accept. That he just went well beyond that. Zhou Enlai, I think, had a somewhat different understanding. Zhou Enlai had a much better understanding of European history because he lived in France for a while. He knew the West. He understood, I think, the Comintern's message probably better than Mao Zedong. And he wasn't quite as enamored of the imperial message that influenced Mao Zedong's heroic image of himself. And so there may be slight differences there. But even then, I think Zhou Enlai would have been very proud of Chinese history and would like Chinese history to somehow integrate with world history in such a way that the world would accept China as being an important part of world history and that China's future role in world history will be greater and greater. I think Zhou Enlai would accept that.
Hmm. Okay, next question. Kai Hong, this is about health, economics, and Mao Zedong. Yeah, then two, and then three. Yeah, please go ahead.
I have my sense of enlightenment and beginning, which was overseas when I was doing my studies, whether in the Duncan libraries of Widener or, say, in the London School of Hygiene or the British Library of Economics and Political Science, where I was working on my PhD, and how of it was history, we had discussed before you. But an interesting thing about the study of health and your history is coming across books, say, when you interpret history from the sense of whether it's coming bottom-up from the social history of ordinary lives of people when you deal with the demography and the epidemiology and the health problems, as in the case of communist China, or when you're dealing with the history of kings and queens, you know. And there was an interesting book I remember written on China where the interpretation of Chinese history was a dynastic one, where even Mao acted in many ways like an emperor, and whether the Communist Party, in fact, was going to a dynastic phase. Would you like to comment on this, the interpretation of history as social history and not of that of kings and queens, and whether the bottom-up approach, which is also a neo-Marxist interpretation of communist history, is accurate?
Well, I think that's a very good question because that's one of the great paradoxes about Mao Zedong, and that in his rhetoric, he always said that the people made history, not kings and queens. He always said that. And one of the most important messages he gave to the Chinese people was that your history has not been written because it's been written only by those officials who are writing the history of the state and the rulers and did not pay attention to your lives. And the revolution that he led was a revolution of the people, for the people. This is how he would have seen it, and I think he believed it. So I call it a paradox, because he believed that. At the same time, he also was, you might say, Chinese enough to believe that leaders, rulers, made the difference. And to be a great leader in China is to lead China to greatness. And that requires that the leader perform certain roles on behalf of the people, as he would see it. And he was trying to square that circle in his own mind. And eventually, I think, as he went on, he became more and more, as he was being deified almost, he became more and more convinced of his historic role as leader to lead China out of that tradition into a new world in which his China would be the leader of the world. And this is how he would justify it. So that paradox remained. For the Chinese people who believed that history was made by the people, I think they couldn't quite accept that. But it was not something that he could articulate in his lifetime. But once he died and Deng Xiaoping came back, as it were, they had a chance to rethink that. And I think the general consensus now is that, no, that is not the way to go. That in his own way, he was actually leading it back to the kind of past of the imperial dynastic China, and he was actually contradicting himself. I'm not sure everybody agrees about that because a lot of debates going on, and incidentally, the profession of history in China is a very powerful one. They are really very large. Every university has a department of history, and there are lots of historians writing and rewriting Chinese history. So the debates are going on right now, very complicated. I can't say I can follow all of it, it's too much for me. But all I can say is that the gap between what Mao Zedong said, that the people made history, and the actions of the leader made history, is one that he could never quite overcome.
Chen Kang? Yeah. And then the gentleman, third row after that, yeah.
Professor Wang, I'm interested in your argument about the dominant position of Jing, the classic, in the Chinese knowledge. And it also reminds me about your another speech on power, rights, and duties, and in which you mentioned about Jing, how Jing can be fabricated, like a Xiao Jing fabricated in the Tang Dynasty, and Zhong Jing fabricated in the Song Dynasty. And you also mentioned about how in the history, in the Confucius history, the duty and the rights have some linkage. And Jin must be Jin, the emperor must be emperor, and then the minister become minister. But along the way, somehow, even the emperor does not behave as emperor, but ministers still have to be minister. So in a way, this Jin is evolving all the time in history. So if you look at it from a perspective of global history, when China opened up and this Jin changes, bring in the foreign contents, isn't it inevitable? Please comment on it.
That's a very good thought. I think there were people who, when they recognized that the modern narrative of the progressive state, a more caring state, a state that did more for people and were representative of people, and people participated in that state, this new kind of state will have a new narrative and an alternative to the Jing of the Confucians. I think there were many in the 1920s, 1930s, including those who supported the Communist Party, including those who supported the Comintern, the Marxist-Leninist ones, because they also thought this was the way to lead away from this imperial dynastic histories into a modern world in which the people made history. If people recognize that people made history, you can develop a new kind of Jing, a new kind of set of norms and rules for the future, derived from the people's power, so to speak, and not the ruler's power. I think people believed that for a while. But it didn't work out like that after 1949. And since 1980s, Deng Xiaoping period, it hasn't come back in any confident way. Because now the new generation of historians after 1980s were exposed very much to the Western historiographical developments since the beginning of the 20th century. Tremendous amount to catch up before they were cut away from it for 40 years. So they rediscovered it in the 1980s and 90s. They were very excited, but they were drawn in many directions because by that time, Western historiography itself had changed so much that the amount of information and amount of learning that they had to relearn was just so much that they haven't quite sorted it out yet. So what we're looking at today, they're trying to rework whether there is another Jing to replace it, both the Confucian Jing as well as the Marx-Lenin Mao Jing. If those two are to be replaced, what to replace it with? Because they haven't replaced it, there's no philosophical basis from which they do that. That is why history has become so important. The history, everything about governance, about politics, about the principles of rule, and past, present, and future continuities, and so on, has replaced it. And out of that history, I'm in a way, I'm concerned, out of that history is this new nationalist history, which have taken from the West, which is extremely attractive, emotionally very satisfying to some people, and extremely powerful once aroused. All these are now entering into the debate, into the discourse in China, so strongly that it may actually prevent them from really discovering their own Jing again and fall into this, to me anyway, a terrible trap for the Chinese people. And I certainly hope they won't do it, but it is there. It is one of the alternate ways of looking at the Jing, to replace all the Confucianism and Marxism with the nation, kind of sacred nation with a capital N. And we know what happened to nations with capital N's. I mean, that has a terrible, to me anyway, a terrible reflection of what the future could bring.
Gentlemen in the third row, then I'll come to the two of you, yes.
So, Wang, you started by talking about your friend, Professor Yun Shi, and his regrets that China didn't turn out the way it should be. Now, what was that, his expectation of China?
Well, he belongs, in fact, there are still lots of people like us who belong to that Mandarin tradition. In other words, our ancestors were literati. His was so, mine too. So I have a sympathy with that. It's a literati tradition who believed that all the educated people, educated to be responsible, to take on the task of bringing about a better world, safer, more harmonious, as it were, all these traditional terms in Confucianism, and they were all strongly imbued with Confucian values, that they have a responsibility towards the state. And these people who put governance, good governance, above all else, are absolutely essential for any country. And these people must be nurtured, carefully protected, so that they can do their job well. This is how the Chinese Confucian tradition has allowed, as it were, whole groups of people to perform that role over the centuries. Yun Shi believes that is not a bad tradition. That could have continued. All you need was to educate the new literati, as it were, with new ideas, with science and new other, and all the Western, the most advanced Western ideas, you re-educate them, but they can still perform that role, be respected for their integrity as scholars and mandarins and literati to do their job. This is the ideal that the Confucians used to have. I think Yun Shi would like to believe that that would have been possible were it not because of the Chinese Communist Party. Because the Chinese Communist Party absolutely destroyed them. And Mao Zedong really destroyed them from the 1950s, from the 100 flowers blooming, didn't bloom, 100 flowers blooming right down to the Cultural Revolution. That whole generation of that tradition was absolutely destroyed. And they have not been able, even till this day, the Communist Party has not been able to recover it. And Yun Shi would say, you look at it today and you see what I mean. He believes that this, what the Communist Party, what has happened to the Communist Party confirms his belief that they took the wrong route. And the correct route was to nurture and retrain, as it were, a new generation of literati with modern knowledge, and they can continue to perform great things for China. This is what he regrets, that it was destroyed by the communists.
Okay, gentleman over there, then third row here. Yeah. Yes, please.
Professor Wang, I was a little bit worried about when you talk about the Chinese version of exceptionalism being a mop-up version of the American exceptionalism. Mm. Because I look at Chinese history and I think that there's a paradox that many people don't realize is that Chinese are very, very historically conscious, because I think that's the only country, every county has a history of its own for thousands of years, and every family has a history of its own for thousands of years. But they are very pragmatic to hold the whole empire together at those times. So the sense of Chinese pragmatism is very strong. One example I can think of is when Deng Xiaoping talked about these Senkaku Islands, he would tell the Japanese Prime Minister that we cannot solve this kind of issue, or we are not wise enough, why don't we leave it to the next generation to resolve it? And when he proposed this one country, two system 30 years ago, many people think that one country, two system might not work very well, and in fact, they give a very short lifespan. But for 15 years, it does work. So the Chinese kind of logic and the way of looking at history and the way they do things, they can say one thing, but they are pragmatic enough to do otherwise, to move things forward. So do you think that if historians can bring this kind of views, it would be easier for foreigners to understand China, why they behave in a certain way? And second question I have is that we have noticed the Sino-Chinese history, whether Jingsi, they are very government-centric, it's dynasty-centric. So some Chinese historian even lamented that Chinese technology during the Song Dynasty was probably the top of the world, but it takes a British historian to write the Chinese science history. So the Chinese history is so dynastic-centric and is so self-righteous that they did not explain very well the actions behind a move and also did not have social, economic, all those dimensions. So it really missed the daily life of the Chinese. So how do you comment on that?
You raised many questions there. I'm not sure I can satisfy you there. But let me take two of the words which you use and say what are the problems that arise from there. You picked me up on the question of exceptionalism. And it is true that the Chinese ideas of their past, the continuity that they have identified with the past, has many exceptional bits to it. Because if you look at the whole world today, where are the historical traditions, the great traditions today? There are essentially three, to my mind, three viable and still powerful traditions today. One of them, which is the most dominant one, came out of the Mediterranean, the Judeo-Christian and the Greco-Roman one fusing into the post-Renaissance and then the modern narrative dominated by, which came out of Western European historiographical thinking. So that's one, that is the dominant one, and it is very powerful. It has taken over all of us. And they've taken it over, in my view, an unfortunate way, because the most attractive part of that narrative has been nation-state narrative. And that, to me, is actually a contradiction in terms of world historiographical tradition. Because the idea that world history is simply adding all nation-state histories together doesn't make sense to me. Anyway, that's my problem. So exceptionalism comes from the fact that the Chinese is the other one. So that is an exceptionalism. American exceptionalism is actually part of Western exceptionalism. It is their continuous history leading in one particular direction, progressive, scientific, and so on, and that's exceptional. Nobody else did that. This is their claim. America is simply the tip of it, the top end of that tradition. The second one is the Chinese one. The third one is the Islamic one. The idea of history being entirely based on the book, on the Quran, everything stems out of it. And history in itself is not important, except that it explains the Quran. It explains how you can carry on and develop the ideas that have been left to us by the Prophet Muhammad. So that is a tradition. It is very alive. It is still there. It hasn't spread to the rest of the world because Islamic countries have been very weak for the last 200 or 300 years. They're partly destroyed by the West itself in the Mediterranean and elsewhere. But these are the three others, because the others are very weak. They have not spread elsewhere. People in Southeast Asia have their little traditions in each part of Southeast Asia, in Africa. Many have been destroyed altogether. The American ones, for example, the South American, Mexican, Inca, and all that, they've all been destroyed. They may have had their own historical traditions. So the only surviving one, the three powerful ones, the Indian one has not been strong, never been strong, because they took time in a different sense. The Indian Buddhist, the Hindu Buddhist tradition has never emphasized history on this earth, as it were. History on this earth is only something that tells you how to behave, how to prepare yourself for life and so on. But the continuity of that history has not been all that important for any of the Indian states the way it has been for the other three. All three of them have one thing in common. They link history with the state. And whether it's a nation state, the Chinese imperial state, or the Quranic state, as it were, the caliphate Quranic state, they all be linked to the state. So those historical traditions that are not linked with the state simply have not been able to compete against this. So that's the important thing. So that exceptionalism is that China is one of the three. And in a funny way, you may not have noticed it, but Samuel Huntington saw that. When he talked about the clash of civilization, he was essentially talking about three, that the West was being challenged by the East Asian or Confucian one, and the Islamic one. So he actually saw that in his own way, except he had, of course, his own particular interpretation. The second word I want to just take up here, and it helps to explain some others, and that is the word empire. Empire, we use the word empire now very loosely. We can even talk about capitalist empires, companies empire, mercantile empires. So it's a very vague word today. But the real meaning of the word comes from the Roman Empire. That's where it comes from, imperium, which is the Roman Empire. So the model, the template for whole of European history is the Roman Empire, from which came the feudal states and then the nation states. The nation states is the climax of that development and is a kind of linear, progressive development, better and better until you have the nation state as the final achievement of Western civilization kind of thing. I mean, that's one way of looking at it. So the empire becomes very central to how it develops. Then if you apply the word empire to other places where they didn't have the word, and you use the word to apply to Japan or China, then it has implications, because once you apply the word, then you try to, as it were, explain that historical developments towards the nation state, you imply that this empire would eventually break up to become little nation states. So that becomes the progressive, unavoidable trend of the future. Then, of course, you reinterpret history in this way. You look at all these places that are called empires. Every single empire has broken down to nation states so far, except China. If China was an empire, then you say, well, China is still calling itself a nation state of something that was called an empire. That, to me, the real problem is not because that is an accurate description. The real problem is because we're using empire and nation in a state which doesn't quite fit the words. You're forcing the words into Chinese history. And one of the reasons why I think the Chinese are quite right to resist that particular narrative, because if you don't resist it, you'll end up by saying the Chinese empire is the last empire to be broken down to proper nation state, which is a norm nation state, and that would be the threat, a great threat to the future of China. You can see what I'm trying to get at, how history can be used in a way which could actually influence the future of the world.
You know, we have reached our time, but I see one young man wants dying to ask a question. Okay. So you're allowed to ask a quick question, and we get a quick response, because there's some very important things like food waiting outside. You
know? Okay. I'm already hungry now, so we have to break. My question is on the relationship between the intellectuals and politics or government, right? So in ancient China, we see a strong connection between intellectuals and politics, right? The 士, 士大夫, 或者士身, is a very fundamental structure in the fundamental level of the society. The bridge is the connections between the government, politics, and the ordinary people, right? They're trying to take advantage of morality, traditions to make the emperors behave themselves, look after their people, just like parents to children. But I didn't see that connection or that relations still exist in contemporary China. So what would be your comments, right? Well, what's your thoughts on
it? If I may go back to Yu Yingshi has some brilliant, he has several brilliant books about the Shidaifu, this scholar literati class that is supposed to provide good governance to make the country safe and peaceful. And he identifies that the Chinese Communist Party is trying to build a kind of new cadre class of people who are also responsible and so on. So Yu Yingshi's quarrel is not with that, because he thinks that that is the only way a country can be run, is by people who are trained and trained to govern and responsible and act responsibly in that area. His problem is that you have to have certain ideals which can guarantee that you produce such responsible people. And what he was saying is, what he believes in, that you can improve on that model if you improve the recruitment from more and more people. And modern history shows that participation of more people, if you educate more people, you have a larger pool to recruit the talent to provide that kind of good governance. And that is progress in the traditional way. You can advance China's Shidaifu idea without actually changing the structure. You improve it by recruiting from a broader and broader base of people who are educated to the sense of responsibility. His argument is that the kind of party that has come out of the Chinese Communist Party, on the one hand, did not do that. They started with revolution, they started with violence, they started with persecution of people with brains, of people who objected to what was happening, and it ended up by a destruction of a whole class of people who could have been very valuable to China, and haven't been able to replace them with another class of people who are equally dedicated and responsible for the state. Now, this is controversial. The Communist Party would not accept that. The Chinese Communist Party would argue that they are now trying to do that. And in many ways, they are. They are succeeding in trying to get good people to come into the government and be part of the responsible governing class. But to what extent this is actually producing these such responsible people is now the question mark that the Chinese Communist Party is facing. And Mr. Xi Jinping at the moment, his biggest problem is how to ensure the quality of all those people who are the top cadres in the country. How can he ensure that these people will be really responsible and do the job properly? So it is not that it hasn't been, not that the Chinese people have given up on that. They just don't know how quite to do it. How to inspire this new class with a new set of Jing. The Jing are the norms, the standards of what is good governance. And at the moment, there's a question mark whether all the ruling elites of the Chinese Communist Party have a Jing that they really believe in. And this is the question mark.
Well, you can tell that we can carry on for a long time, but we have two very important things to do. We have to actually officially launch the book. That is. And we also have to have a good... We have to make sure you visit the Lee Kuan Yew School of Free Food also. But before moving on to that, I'm sure you all agree that this has been absolutely fascinating. The great thing about listening to Gungwu is that each time you learn new things, each time you get new insights, and more importantly, each time when you leave the lecture, you will go back thinking, oh my God, how much did I learn today? So thank you very much again, Gungwu. And I wish you all the best.
Ladies and gentlemen, now let's put our hands together for the official launch of the book. For joining us at the launch of the book Renewal, the Chinese State and the New Global History in Singapore.
The Lee Kuan Yew School of Public Policy.